Okay, good morning. So if you have any CS1 access issues, CS1, CS2 access issues, check with me, certainly, okay? First thing I would say is try to log in the lab. Rule out your PC issues, okay? Try to log in. The X Manager is installed in the lab, okay? Try to log in the lab. If not, email CS Tech. I believe that's correct. CS-Tech. Okay. Mention what error message. Particularly if it says you are not authorized to access the system, something like that, then that's certainly they have to look into it. And your NetID, right? Of course, email. Send email from your UTD address, of course, okay? NetID and the course number. Mention that you are registered in this course, so why I'm not able to access, okay? Any questions about this? I hope all of you have tried already. You haven't postponed that, right? You have already tried. So, okay. One more thing I want to mention. Based on the past semesters, next few lectures are very boring to look at. Much better if you bring a laptop together. You do along with me, you do commands, and that's much better way of learning, okay? Otherwise, you'll fall asleep. Because it's very hard to be too excited about command line, all these commands, you're watching me typing, you know? It's not much fun, okay? So I strongly encourage you to bring your laptop and do the commands along with me, next to 2-3 classes, until we jump to C++, okay? Today is going to be a lot of concepts and stuff, so we are okay today, okay? So, but next class onwards, I'll start to go into command line, trying out various things. I want you to try with me, okay? As much as possible. If you don't have a laptop, try to sit near someone who has a laptop and try to work with them, okay? So, any questions about it? If you do ask a question, I may repeat the question so that it gets recorded, okay? So, just to let you know. Okay, so, this is a few things I kind of wrote down based on my observations, what I have seen and what I have read everywhere and all those things. So, originally designed in AT&T Labs in 1960s, UNIX itself. Unlike the other operating system. There were several other operating systems too. VAX and a few others. VAX is what I remember. VAX used to be called. Now, remember those days, Windows didn't exist. DOS didn't exist. Okay, this came first. Okay. So, UNIX and a few other operating systems came first. They are all kind of commercial operating system. That's not meant for personal use. That's why Windows is a first personal use type of thing. Of course, there are a few others, but not so popular ones at least, right? So the thing very unique about UNIX is that 95% or even more was written in C language. That's special because until then, several other operating systems were directly written in assembly and not so portable languages, okay? Most of them were assembly, I believe. Imagine writing the whole OS in assembly language. It's hard to even imagine now, right? But that's what they did at those days. Of course, the operating systems are a lot smaller. They provided very limited functionality, okay? So, not as complicated as current days. So, what is so special about that? This 95% source code C language. Why am I even mentioning? Yes? That's right. Remember those days, various machines, even UNIX was running in different hardware environments. It could support different hardware environments. So if you let's say somebody else came with a new chip, a new environment, right? Microprocessor, you want to run UNIX OS, you want to put there, the 95%, hopefully you don't need to touch it. Only that 5% or whatever is the small assembly language portion. Assembly language is different for each microprocessor, right? Okay, each microprocessor has its own instruction set and all that, right? 8086 family of microprocessor instructions are very different from Z80 and any other microprocessor for that matter, okay? So that's just an optional sheet. It's a list of the workshops that are coming up. So I unexpectedly printed too many. I thought it's a good place to bring it in. So so it's a very small percent assembly language that we have to rewrite. Every hardware new environment you go, you have to rewrite, no choice, okay? So instead of writing 100% of the code, you write a very minimal percentage of the code. So you may be thinking, why bother? Why don't you write everything in C? Why not 100%? It's very hard to write 100% in C itself. Any ideas, any thoughts, why we cannot do it? True. You need a compiler, okay. There are some functions that don't support. There are functions very critical, you know, like context switching and all that, very time critical or something. There's nothing like programming in assembly, really. If you really want to have a control of CPU, it's very hard to beat it. You know, you go to assembly level, you really have full control, almost full control, much better than C. From Java, higher level language, you have a lot less control over CPU. So that's why many people say C itself is a low level language. You might have read somewhere, right? So because in C, actually, I have seen code like this. Within C itself, you can write like this. ASM. ASM and assembly instruction. You can put the assembly instruction within C program too. I've seen code like that. So you have multiple lines of ASM within brackets, move AX comma something, you know, all that we have seen, you know. So it supports, not only it's kind of gives a lot of control, it even supports assembly instruction. In fact, many times you do that too, you know. So I have seen OS drivers and all that, you have seen this code. Obviously that's not portable. That code is not portable, right? Even though this is within a C file, when you move it to the other microprocessor, you have to port that statement. See, this portion has to be ported, see? Meaning, you have to replace it with the appropriate instructions for that target environment, right? So that's once you throw in statements like that, it's as good as assembly code, okay? So you have to port it manually, okay? So the small percentage assembly language is very common in most operating system code because the criticality and the control of the CPU that can be done only from the assembly language, okay? So the UNIX is supported in multiple hardware environments. So we need to port and build the image, build the executable for each hardware environment, okay? Let's say you design your own chip. Just like Intel CPU, if you design your own but totally different instruction set, so you can download the you do few things first. First you need a compiler, right? Kind of you have to do cross compilation. Who knows what that means? Cross compilation. Cross compilation? We know compilation. Cross compilation is you compile in Windows, but target is something else. Meaning the binary, you are going to run it in some other place. That's what cross compilation is. Cross compilation is popular in embedded systems. Let's say real-time systems, you have some sensor device, for example, you are running a program in that sensor device. You develop everything in Windows, but the executable is going to run in this microprocessor, that's a sensor device microprocessor, which can be something totally different, 8085 or some other tiny microprocessor, not so powerful at all, because you don't need it, right? So embedded device, you may put some microprocessor, depending on the device, it's just a sensor or something, you don't need much power, right? So but you may build the application still in Windows. So then you use a special compiler. Okay? Special compiler which generates binary code for that microprocessor. That's called cross compilation. Okay? So you need some cross compilation first, you know, to develop a cross compiler for this new platform. Then you try to kind of build the OS using that some other system. Then you kind of put the binary stuff, binary image in the target environment. Okay? So that's how you kind of develop the OS for the new processor. Okay? Initially, UNIX was pretty much used by their research organizations and later by big companies. Banks like Citibank, for example, you know, so one of the early adopters of the machines because they got a lot of data, right? And so on, lot of commercial companies. Then lot of things happened, went through several splits, unlike Windows. Probably hard to see anything here. So let's see whether we can see anything. Okay, so that's a UNIX, that's, I think that's the Bell Lab AT&T original one, 1969, the year I was born. So UNIX and I were born together. BSD is Berkeley, University of California, Berkeley. They took a version and they started developing their own. That's what happens when one company does not want, unlike Microsoft, right? So you don't find, you don't go out and find Windows 10 different versions, 10 different distributions and all that. That's because one company wants everything. They have a lot tighter control. They navigate, they develop the plan, you know, they, all those things. Whereas here, it was kind of developed by AT&T, but that since the source code is available for everybody, right? Because that's the only way they can port the UNIX to some other OS, right? So by nature, it was available for everybody, right? So they're able to take it, they're able to develop on their own. Why? Because see, every company or every institution thinks various functionalities are important. So the main guys, AT&T Labs, are not doing, we will do it ourselves, okay? So I think Berkeley, these guys were very interested in developing more networks type of things, networking functionality. So they took over and did a lot of networking functionality, okay? In fact, they developed their own few commands too. So you sometimes you will see documentation saying that, you know, it came from Berkeley BSD Linux, BSD Unix, okay? So then you can see some Sun Microsystems took it here. There was a Xenix and system. This is IBM, I believe, if I'm right. System 3, System 5. You know, so it's mind-boggling number of variations. HP, no company want to be left behind, so everybody had their own versions. That was actually quite popular. I have seen HP desktops, you know, quite a bit for development environment. In fact, even I think I had it as a desktop once. Maybe as a terminal to a UNIX machine, maybe. Okay, so let's go this side. Then, finally, Minix and Linux here. And, okay, so let me make this a little bit smaller again. What is this color code? The green is the open source. Kind of red is the closed source. It's kind of like a commercial software because you can see Sun Microsystems and SCO Unix and HP. Obviously, they're not going to give out the code outside, right? So they're closed source and they kind of shared. This one is mixed or shared source because I think they're forced to share because of the way Unix was developed. Anyway, Linux is right here. So according to this, Linux started around 1990-91. Okay. So right about the time you guys are born. Is that right? Yeah. Okay. So you are Linux people. So Linux is, I think, probably next page or something. Any questions about this slide? Don't worry, I won't ask any questions based on this. Which year Unix was done? Nah, that and all you got done in school. I don't want to do all those type of things. This is not a memorization based thing. Okay, so let's go to the next one. So bottom line is that's what happens when one company doesn't want, you know. So even Linux is the same thing too, Linux distributions, right? Okay, that's something I want to show. Okay. Yeah, that's what it was. Okay. So the difference between Unix and Windows then. Unix was started as a multi-user OS. Why is that? Very expensive. It was mainly our research organizations and companies. Okay. By the way, since I'm recording, until I get a wireless mic, I cannot move from here. I'm stuck here. Okay. I would like to walk around, but for now, next to a few classes, then I'll get a wireless mic. So it started as a multi-user OS, and security was a big deal. Let's say all of us are working for one company, right? We are all excited that we got this new Unix OS, right? So is the security very important? You log in, you should be able to have your own files, right? And you want to give public access, others to access, some files you want to keep it secretive, some files you want to access, if they are draft documents or something, you want to share with only your team, right? Certainly, you don't want to log in and delete others' files. Sometimes you may want to, but you shouldn't be able to. Right? So one user should not be able to delete other user's files unless other user gives you the permission. I don't know why you would do that, but you can. Certainly, we don't want one user to delete the system files. One user, regular user, shouldn't be able to log in and bring the system down. In Windows, very much you could do that for a long time. Maybe now it's kind of getting better. Still, even now, you can just go to system and delete few files. Next time it will not boot up. Good luck. Right? Because that's a personal OS. Still, it's you are responsible for the machine, whatever is in it. So whatever you do, you face the consequences. So that's one thing in CS1, CS2. Whatever you do, the worst case you can do is delete your own files. That's all the worst you can do. You don't need to worry. Now just relax your mind and play with the commands. When you go to next classes and everything, we'll be playing with a lot of commands. Okay? So if it really, let's say you manage to bring the system down, let's say Linux system, CS1 or CS2, if you log in, you manage to bring the system down, it's not your fault. That's kind of telling a kid now, it sounds like. It's a CS tech fault. They have configured that way. They shouldn't have allowed you to do certain type of things. So that's a misconfiguration. That's how I see it. Okay? It's not your problem. See, we don't say this thing every day, you know. Usually it's your problem. If you do something. Okay? So security is a big deal right from the start. Because it's just serious nature of the thing, and it's mainly for research organization, mainly big companies. The security is extremely big deal. Whereas Windows, when it started, it was started before you guys were born, I think. So it started as a DOS, and it comes in this two floppy disks or something, right? You can delete this stuff, gone. Okay? So security is not even considered security because it's a single user OS. In fact, the initial version doesn't even ask for user ID. You put it in, boot up, you're in. Okay? So nowadays, of course, it's a lot better. They have kind of converged and Windows has come all the way to have that same level of security, I would say. So back to Unix. Admin versus user. There's extreme difference is very clear. Admin can bring the system down. As part of the job, sometimes he has to bring the system down. Right? That's why it's called as a root access. Any Linux experts here? I saw from few messages where you have Linux as the desktop, laptop, Linux is what you use. How many? Okay. Correct me if I say anything wrong. You know, those guys probably know more about Linux than me. Okay. I'm more towards programming and the command line and all that. I don't know about OS level that much. Okay. So that's why that there is one workshop, right? The Mint OS installation and all that details they'll go through. You know, you're welcome to attend that, you know, so to kind of dig into OS, you know, below the user level, you know, how is the OS is configured, you know, all those things. We will not cover that here. Okay. So guys, correct me if I say something wrong or you want to add on something, you know, so please. So Windows, they didn't even ask for user ID, so there's no difference between admin and user. Those days, nowadays much better, right? We're pretty close. So Unix started with a command prompt. Windows started with a command prompt too. I think that was what? DOS 1.0, DOS 2.0, DOS 3.0, 3.1 is when it became Windows. That's the time the Windows came in. Okay, there are three versions of, I believe that's correct, three versions of the DOS was there, which is only command based. Okay, so no Windows. So I remember my friends actually programming in this Windows 3.1 and all that. They're all excited and they do this Windows based programming. To open one window, they write 20 lines of code with all those parameters and everything. If you miss one parameter, nothing will show up. I'm glad we are very different now. Unix has a very sophisticated CPU scheduler, so that, remember, it's a shared system, very expensive system, very powerful for the operations we do. So usually one big machine connected with several terminals. So how does it look? Typical configuration is this. Machine, Unix machine, and typically there is one console. And then you have, that's what the computer room is all about. You have the computer room and have bunch of Do we have any historian here who likes all these historical things? What are these terminals called? I know, that's not very nice to terminals, but that's what we used to call dumb terminals. They are 18 to 25. In fact, usually it's a green color, monochrome. 18 to 25, probably should have drawn this in green and the other one in blue. 18 to 25, okay. What does that mean? 80 length, width, and 25 height. Meaning characters, 80 characters width and 25 characters height, okay? So everybody was sitting in this machine, so proud of using the computer, they felt that it's their machine, you know? That's what time shared system, right? They are all sharing the machine, right? So Unix is very much a time shared OS. So, of course, you know, certainly what others are doing does impact you, but the scheduler is so sophisticated that it tries to be nice to everybody, okay? By default, of course, you can set it up as a priority user and everything, then it will be different, okay? But by default, it will try to take the kind of like round robin approach and try to schedule you in, okay? Okay. Windows started with a really simple scheduler. So initially, at least, once your task is running, that's it. Scheduler doesn't even get any control of it until the task gives up. If the task goes to infinite loop, bye-bye. Right? No return to OS. Okay? Time to reboot. A universal solution for all problems. Right? So that's what the simple scheduler it was. Even now, actually, a lot of embedded system uses a simple scheduler. Why you don't want complex scheduler? You don't need it. Yes? Lot of CPU, it's a dead time, right? All the sophistication, if you don't need it, it's a dead time. You don't want to affect the CPU, right? We want the actual processes to run in the CPU instead of the scheduler running around, you know. It's overhead from our purpose, right? Okay. So, but of course, now the latest Windows scheduler, I have a feeling it's as complicated as Windows 1. Okay? You can have multiple people can log in. It's almost, I think our machine kind of works like a server now, you know. So, you can do remote login, right? Remote to your PC and multiple users can use, you know. So then you have the same scheduling issues coming into play, right? So then next one is this difference you might have already noticed, right? So the Windows, we always use this as the directory path and everything, whereas Unix uses this forward slash, that's a backward slash. So you can see the Unix influence on the websites, right? So websites is basically from the Unix influence. That's why URLs we use forward slash. Okay, we talked about that already. Time sharing, multiple users, text-based terminals, security and scheduler were extremely important pieces, right? Since we are doing so much text input, short and cryptic commands are extremely important, right? Let's say you're listing file, list, copy, copy. You'll be getting tired of typing these commands, right? Move, move, right? Like that. Instead of that, these are popular commands. List, we use ls. Copy, CP, right? I don't know if I spelled it right. Just to make the dog unhappy. Cat, actually, it's kind of silly, the term. What it is listing multiple files, concatenate the files, and show the contents. That's what that means. You can specify the multiple files to show all the files content together. So instead, you just say cat space file name, file name, file name. You'll see all those things in detail, OK? So anyway, you get the idea, right? Because when you're going to type so much, obviously, you want to use a short, cryptic ones. That's what you guys do in SMS nowadays, right? LOL, same thing. Hey, these guys are not as crazy as you think, you know. Just that they didn't know about SMS, they used this, so, you know. So you're just using it for a different purpose. They were typing to the terminal, you are typing in cell phones. That's the only difference. Okay. They were typing lots of time, you are typing lots of times too. See? Guys are not laughing. Okay. So each command, another thing is, you know, Unix, they kept a lot of commands, you know, so keep it simple and what's the KISS principle, I guess, right? So each command is really simple and does only one functionality. We don't have any too complicated command which does all kind of things. So then the user can combine them and using pipe operator, which will spend quite a bit of time, okay? And to get to do very complex operations. One command, you can do, assemble the simple commands together, one command line, you can write to do solve the whole problem. You know, some big data file, take it and process it, generate a nice report. You can do it from one line. Okay, it almost looks magical. You'll see all those details. Okay, that's one of the things you will learn. Later, UNIX had the graphics terminals. The first graphics terminal came for the console, I think, because again, it was expensive, so it's one terminal. Then later, the other terminal also got upgraded. Then this X server and clients came. If you want to read more details, our UNIX, the Linux book has more details, okay? So UNIX was bulky, just like Windows. Just that Windows, now we have a bigger machine, so we can run it, right? Windows, how much memory it takes? 1 GB or something now, you know, when you run, you know. You cannot run that in the old processors, right? In fact, Linux is famous because of that. Old PCs, if you try to put the latest Windows, you cannot even put it in, you know. So you don't have enough main memory and all those problems, right? So a lot of Linux distributions, right, there is one you can put it in USB drive or something like that. There's a tiny Linux distribution, you can run it in any old machine, you know. So if you want grandma to use email, that's perfect. Take your old machine, put a Linux, install, you know, desktop, the browser, it's all set. She need not worry about virus and all those things. See, so perfect for grandma, Linux is. Okay, or grandpa. Okay, so Unix was bulky. It was really never meant for personal or very small scale use. Okay, so that's why the Linux came to play. Linux is, unlike Unix, Linux was specifically for PC hardware. Right, it is the Intel platform, this 8086 based processors. So Linux is really, the concepts came from Unix. Somewhere I read that no code was copied. Even one line of code was not copied from Unix. Okay? How much true, I don't know. So we have to ask Linus Trivals, right? His name was. So he's the guy, even now Linux kernel is managed by one person, him. So Linus, his name is. So that's why they named Linux. So Linux is adaptation, stripped-down version of Unix for PC hardware. Just like Unix, several distributions of Unix are available. So here are a few more of those, right? Mint, Arch. We ran Arch Linux workshop in summer, and Mint is what we are going to run on September 7th. And I'm sure there are several more. I have Ubuntu desktop and as a dual boot in this. I haven't used it recently because a lot of things we run are on Windows because of the training and all those things, but I do have Ubuntu here. So the GUI has been improved a lot. One of the problem with the Linux was the early version of Linux was still command line. The GUI was not great and all that. So now I think GUI is pretty good, right? It's almost as good as or even better than Windows desktop, you know. So there is supposedly there is one Linux some standard. If you the distribution kind of satisfies that standard, then you can do binary files. You have binary built in one Linux machine, can Linux distribution can be copied to another distribution. I can still run it. Okay. You may be thinking, well, it's Linux, it's on PC hardware. Can I run the binary executable from Windows and Linux? After all, same microprocessor. Can we not run the binary, share the binary between Windows and Linux? No? Why not? At least hardware-wise, that's not the difference. Hardware is same. You're running it on this PC, yes? Different standards, okay. OS has different commands. One other thing I can think of is this dynamic linked library type of thing, right? The library which is already in memory. So your binary is not really complete. It's getting linked when you're loading it. When you're running it, it kind of gets connected to the dynamic library. That library is very different from Windows versus Linux. Okay. Yes, microprocessor instructions are no problem. They do same instruction because it's the same hardware. But a lot of other things above that, basically, they are quite different. Okay. Main thing I can think of is that library, dynamic DLL, dynamic link library, which is different in both environments. So it cannot, you cannot simply copy and run. In fact, for same reason, even within Linux distribution itself, there are some problems, unless they follow some standard. Okay, look into that. Maybe that's a good discussion question. Okay. So Linux, type in Linux binary compatibility, you will get a lot of interesting articles. Okay, look into that. Why learn Linux? We are all so good in clicking and running. Why should we bother to learn Linux? Why should we bother to learn this command line business? You know. So, lot of times I kind of look at it historically. The old days meaning 10, 20 years ago, all the mail server, any type of server ran Unix or Linux, primarily Unix, I guess. So, why? The Windows server crashes 10 times a day, right? If at all the Windows server was there. Initially it was not there, then it came, but security and the stability was so poor at that time, okay? So at that time Unix was very stable right from the start, so servers were all were running Unix and later in Linux, as simple as that, okay? Yes, right now Windows server is probably as good as Unix server, you're right. And they came late, just like our BlackBerry touchscreen thing. It may be a very good right now, but very late to the party, right? Will you switch, all of you, will you switch to BlackBerry just because that's equally good or even better? Nah, thanks. No, we don't want to learn one more thing. We are very happy with our iPhone and Android phones, right? So very late to the party. So same way. Probably situation is a little bit better here. I think Windows Server is quite common nowadays. There's a lot more movement between both. People do replace Unix servers with Windows servers and Windows servers with Unix servers. You know, unlike our phone dearness thing, you know, so there's a lot more movement between those. So Windows servers are quite popular now, okay? But equally popular are the Unix and Linux. I think it has stabilized over time. I don't know what the market share is. That's another thing you guys can find out. What's the Windows server, any type of server purpose, web server, database server, you know, mail server, all those things. Which one is common? Which OS? Historically, it was Unix and Linux. Now, I'm sure the Windows kind of kept eroding it, but still significant percentage, still Unix and Linux. The lot of network management entities run on Unix. When I was working in Samsung, the wireless network, you need a wireless network, a lot of embedded devices, the tower equipment, right? Tower equipment uses real-time Linux, by the way, nowadays. All the embedded stuff runs real-time Linux, okay? So then you need some entity to manage them, right? You need to know which device is going down. Maybe when it reboots, you need to give the software, all those things, the management entity. That was running Sun Solaris. Sun Solaris is a Unix offshoot, right? In that page you saw Sun OS, right? So Sun Solaris is very popular in telecom industry, okay? So that's what I meant by this management entity. So Sun Solaris OS, okay? It's very popular. I think they also provide the lot of nice packaging to provide 5 nines reliability. Have you heard about it? 5 nines reliability. What that means is 99.99% guaranteed to be uptime. Okay, so reliability is extremely good. Okay, so under some standards, some specifications. Okay, so that obviously applies to not just software, so hardware, primarily hardware, I would say. Reliability or uptime. lot of embedded devices. We used to run lot of embedded devices, telecom industry. I'm from telecom industry. Lot of ones used to run very preparatory OSs all the time, all homegrown. Nortel had, when it was Nortel, Nortel had their own protocol, their own language, DMS, I think, that's their own OS for all these real-time nodes. Ericsson had their own OS, preparatory, and their own stuff. You know, like the, every company had their own. Now, everybody has kind of converged on, most of them have converged on the Linux, real-time Linux. There are a few others too. I think I heard about Vertex is another one, and there are a few others. But nobody have, rarely now people have, companies have preparatory OSs, okay? They want to take advantage of what's out there and build, finish the build out quickly. Next one is actually, I was discussing with one guy who just our graduate student, returned from Amazon.com after internship, summer internship. That's what they heavily use, Ruby on Rails. And Ruby on Rails is running on Linux. That's a configuration they use for dynamic web pages and all kind of things. I don't understand fully, but that's what he claims, and he is one of the presenters in that Ruby on Rails workshop. Okay? So, I mean, you guys are at the right time where you are, I'm sure you want to do internships and other things, you want to boost up your skills. So, looks like that's one of the important ones, you know. So it's always great to listen to the guys who are coming back from the industry, you know, after doing internships. So they are very much in touch with the latest things. So, okay. And of course, Linux is free. Probably that should be in the top. Okay. Personally, you know, I felt that, you know, you also think like that, right? Something free, how can it be so good, right? So, but it's a lot of things what we use are free, you know. So, in fact, all the workshops, pretty much nothing is really paid software. It's all free software we are using. So, I mean, they're extremely reliable and open source. Very good. Okay, we are kind of digging deeper now. I think I have a picture to kind of show this. So a lot of concepts came from Unix. All that concepts went to a lot of other voices. I want to say something, but I realize that I'm recorded too, so I don't want to say it. So, and it, I may put it in YouTube, whole world can see it, you know, then that won't be good. Okay, so a lot of concept went into other voices, so I have to be politically correct, I guess. I didn't know all about these problems. Okay. Maybe I shouldn't put it in the YouTube. Inode structure is probably a good one to look at, but let's see. This is inode structure. We'll come back to this one. Okay. This is probably a good place to start. So Windows file system, right? Typically, how do we access C drive? You can, if you have one more partition, D drive, right? And you put your USB drive, that becomes another drive. So within that, then you use the directory structure and you access that. We all familiar with that, right? So how is the Unix, Linux, and others? That's how it looks in Unix. The same configuration, right? So can be kind of mapped like this. In fact, here itself, Windows itself, this is kind of strange, see? See, this doesn't follow the same pattern. That's kind of merge between the Unix and Windows in a sense. So, I got tired of saying Unix and Linux, just say star Nix. So, everything comes under one tree structure. So, this is a root. We call this a root, okay? So, which is also mentioned as a slash, okay? So everything is with respect to the root, okay? So when you go to your home directory, print working directory, yeah, Every time I got to change this too. Is that better? Okay. So that's how my directory is. So you can do slash what is in the root. Okay. That are just a few more things, but we are not getting into command line today. So that's the that's kind of just to give you an idea. So then let's see the network drives and a few devices. I think that's probably local devices. That's certainly a local device. That's some hard disk, I think. Slash dev. There are, see, they are mapped to this. These are all devices, and the devices are mapped to this location. Okay? So these are logical names. These are kind of physical little bit. This is a logical where how they are kind of mounted on. That's what the previous slide talks about, mounting. Mount points to mount each storage device or even logical device. Lots of concepts went to other OSs. The inode structure we'll look at. And then there's a concept called hard links and symbolic links. This is the probably the first kind of serious concept we'll look at. Let's see. What else I want to cover here before we go into that. Okay, the inode structure. I have a better picture here. See, you need a way to how the files are stored, basically. That's what this is. This structure, one structure is responsible for storing the whole data, managing everything about the file except the file name. Okay? So, within the Unix environment, every file, every entity that stores the data is given a number, inode number. Okay? So, it's kind of inside, but you kind of look at as the files. See here, when you do ls, your home directory or something, you see these files, right? Then I do ls minus I, then I get a number. See, ls minus I is that inode number. What is the number corresponds to that file? So given this number, ID number, right? If you want to call it, this is kind of like your name, and you have the ID, right? So internally, everything is managed by this ID. For that each ID, this is a structure you store. For each ID, this is a structure you store, right? A mode, file type, and permission. We talked about that. Whether you want to be private, you want to share it with a group, you want to share with the whole world, okay? That type of things. Link count, I'll come back and explain. Owner's ID and owner's group ID, okay, file size, time it was last access, timestamp basically, and last access, last modified. This is the file contents, that's what that means. File content was modified. This is the time inode was last changed. Inode is that big block, right? So big block, and this content is changed, some permissions were changed, so on. Then you have something called pointers. It's not to be confused with our C++ pointers, it's rather block numbers. You have the individually in the disk, you have the data blocks, you know, multiple sectors together is called as a data block. So here in this example, 8 kilobytes, need not be same in every system. It will vary based on your volume size, disk size. So in this example, 8 kilobytes, okay? And you have 12 direct blocks. What does that mean? There are 12 of those here. Since we have 12 of those, and each one is 8 kilobytes, so 12 into 8, 96 kilobytes, right? As long as your file size is less than 96 kilobytes, that's all you need. Okay? I'll come back and explain that once more, okay? If the file size is greater than that, then you need the indirect block pointers. You kind of store your external index block and store block numbers here. If it's bigger than that, you need one more level of indirect block. See, the data is here, data is here, data is here, data is here, so on, okay? So that's how you manage the big files using the same inode block. Inode block size is fixed. You know, you cannot, as the file becomes bigger and bigger, if you throw in the block numbers inside, then the inode structure itself will become variable size, right? Do you agree? If you store all the block numbers, the inode structure will become small, big. You cannot manage that. When you do array of something, it's very hard to manage something that's shrinking and expanding, right? If you're trying to keep it like an array, one of the main thing in array is that it has to be fixed size. Right? If at all something is not fixed size, in like in Java you may see some objects are not fixed size, they are stored externally, they are not stored inside the array. You may, right? So whatever is the array component, if you look at it, it's always fixed size. Okay? So that's why we have this extensions. Okay? Then you have some flags and stuff that's not extremely important. Let's see. You have a lot of details here. I will post this too. Okay? So let me take a step back and explain some more. I think there is one slide here. Yeah, okay. Remember, I said there's a ls minus I command shows you the inode numbers and the file names, right? So those inode numbers, right? So let's say ls, you do 10, 10, 11, ls.txt. And then something like 71 something is another file, x.txt. So this is nothing but an index into the inode array. This is the inode array, right? That's the inode array. And these guys are indexed into this. So this is going to be somewhere here, right? Somewhere here. So let's see. Right? So somewhere here, right? So somewhere here, this is just like array index. That's array index. Nothing but it's array index. Okay? Are you with me? I know this is the first concept and we are 11 o'clock. You guys are getting hungry probably. Right? So stay with me. So this one, this basically points to this block where it talks about what's the permissions associated with the data and all those type of things, except the file name. Remember, file name is within the directory itself. We'll cover that a little bit later too. Okay? So given the inode number, you can access the inode block. Then that inode block has the direct block numbers. Let's say this is the file you're looking at, or let's say take this file. So it has block number this is a, how is the index? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, like that, just like array, right? Similarly, block numbers also 0, 1, 2, all the way to some maximum number. Okay, so let's say there's a block number 1, block number 3, and so on. So what that means is that file x.txt has the actual data in block number 1 and block number 3, so on. Questions? I know it's pretty deep. For the second class. Yeah.
So the inode array is pointing to the block.
Yeah, it just has the block numbers. That's correct. That's correct. So let's go back here. Now hopefully this makes a little bit more sense. Yeah, go away. So this is nothing but okay, my screen is here still. Okay, that's because of this guy. Okay, so here, right here, you have array of 12 numbers. That's all it is. The 12 direct block pointers, nothing but array of 12 numbers, which are used as the index to access the data blocks. So once you cross 96 kilobytes, what happens in this diagram? What happens once you cross the file size 96 kilobytes? So you go over this 12 blocks, 12 block numbers, you need one more. We don't have space for one more. Instead, you have one single indirect block pointer. It points to another data block you are going to borrow and use that as an index block. You will put the number here. You are going to waste one more data block for storing the index. Okay? Because you went over that 12. So 100 kilobytes? Yes, we will be wasting one block just to store one number. That will go on all the way to 16 MB because this guy has 2048 block numbers it can store. Okay? Once you go beyond that, then you need the next level of redirection. One double indirect one, right? So then see, what is the double indirect? Indirect number, and there's one more, this is index block, second level index, this is a first level index, then the actual data. Okay? So that's how you can manage the big, really big files, huge files you can manage because of this mechanism, this indirect mechanism. See, that's a direct access, this is one level indirection, this is a two level indirection, right? And this will be three level indirection. See, one, two, three, four. Tons of blocks, right? You can store, you can go all the way to 70 terabytes. That should be enough, we hope. Usually that's a lot more than your disk size. So that's certainly enough. This is, I think, based on this example. I'm sure there's another example or bigger. For example, can be data block can be different. Typically, what you see online, you can check, you know, what's the data block size or file system, Windows file system, something. Depending on your volume, depending on the drive size, this size varies. Yes, I want to say something. Inode is mapping to your file names. Inode is one entity, one data entity. Whatever you are storing the data, for our purpose, it's one file. File name maps to one inode. That inode block is in charge for, it's kind of like a tree structure below that.
Okay.
Right? The tree can be small or big. See, a tree has up to 12 children, 13th, 14th children are special. Right, they have their own bigger trees, right? So that's how you look at it. You understand what I mean? Probably, I see. So one inode block, it can have 0, 1, 2, up to all the way to 11 direct blocks, right? So that's the data, right? So that's data blocks, actual data. Then if you go over that, you have one more index block. That will have, the whole index block is used for storing block numbers. I think that's what the example shows, 0, 1, 2, up to 2048, I think, 47, right? So that's a lot of data blocks. So the inode, this is actually, this is a, just a struct, that's very small, okay? But these guys are data blocks. So you can see the, if you do go over that, you need one more. And that will be multiple levels again, the two level ones. Beyond that is when you get the data blocks. Yeah. Right? Like that. You get the idea? That's how you expand the file size. See, I should have drawn left side. There's one more level, we know that, right? The triple level. So, does this make sense? Sir? Makes you understand some more. So smaller file, anything less than 12 blocks in this example, basically you won't need this extra, this huge tree structures, but as it becomes bigger and bigger, and you can waste a lot of space for internal, the index blocks. We call that index blocks here. Questions? Looks like you have a question. You're thinking too hard. Yeah, it's mainly for hard disk though, right? Everything is in the hard disk, right? This is really file management, right? You're managing how you manage the files in the disk. Yeah, mm-hmm. That's right. In fact, remember when you have a directory structure, when you do list the directory, directory itself is a special file. Directory is nothing, it's a special kind of file, so which happens to contain file name and the number, right? So the one of these files, one of the inodes will be pointing to a directory itself, right? The current directory is inode 2. In fact, you will see that here. When you do ls minus, let's see, what is that? Id dot. See, the current directory, that's the inode number. So if I go one level up, let's say ls minus, I just do ls minus I. Okay, see, each directory here, for directory also there's inode number, see? That's me. Every entity that stores data has a inode. Whether it's a file or it's a directory or anything, basically, typically it's either file or directory, right? Typically. So when you do ls, actually that's a system functionality, that when you do ls, what it does, it simply goes to that inode, corresponds to the current directory, right, reads the data and displays. Reads the file names and displays. It doesn't display inodes because you didn't ask for it. So when I do minus I, it displays the inode numbers too. Then when you are doing something, you want to look at something like this, what it does, goes back there, goes back to the current directory. You know, current directory file, nothing but just like a parallel array, right? File name and the inode number, right? So that gets that inode number for corresponding file, ls minus ls.txt, that's the inode number, takes that inode number, goes in and gets the data and displays like that. That's the contents of that file. Let's look at some other file, maybe ls minus I, okay, x.c, let's say, cat x.c. So that will go to the inode number, this 140457, right? To go to that inode, that's where the x.c is stored, right? So you may be wondering, why don't we store the file names in inode and get it over with? You know, the inode structure does not have the file name. This mapping is only in the directory, see? Current directory, okay? It will become clear probably next class. We'll cover the symbolic links and direct links, then it will become clear, okay? For now, just look at this as, you know, how the numbers are mapped. You have a current directory. Let me explain that alone once more. That's the current directory. So when you do just minus I alone, it shows the list the current directory. So here what I meant by D is that I know it's a directory, just tell me what the directory information is. Do not list what is in the directory. See, if I do without ID, it shows what is inside the directory. Okay, so that's about the directory information. When you do like this, it shows what the current directory has, and this is one of the file, x.c, for example, and that's the inode number. When I do cat x.c, I want to look at what's inside. It goes through the same process. It goes to the current directory inode, it knows that, and from it accesses and finds this inode number, goes and accesses that access inode number and gets the data and displays. Yes. No, absolutely not. It does. Each command is independent, really. You can just log in and do directly. User doesn't care about inode. Even experienced Unix user, Linux user, you tell them inode, what? They may say that, you know. Just a typical user. They may not know anything about inode. The inode is a below the carpet, right? Above the carpet, you see only the file names. Okay. Later, I will show some example next class to show that, you know, why the kind of file name is a little bit loosely coupled with inode. I will explain that in the next class. Okay. Okay. So this one, inode structures. Any questions about this picture? So it's array of objects in a sense. That's all it is. The inodes, inode size is probably, I would say, 100 bytes or 50 bytes, something like that. Okay. Top one, that each one is not a data block. Okay. Inode struct is very small size. Okay. Because we want to have a lot of inodes. Remember, more number of inodes you can have, more number of files and directories you can have within the system, right? So, for example, theoretically speaking, if you create a lot of tiny files, you may run out of inodes before you running out of data blocks, right? Depending on your configuration, you may run out of inode block space before running out of data block if you create a lot of tiny files. So we talked about what happens when you have this. So when a file becomes big, beyond that 96 KB or something, the index block, we waste space in index block. Is there any other wastage of space? Well, how about small files? Do we waste any space at all? What do you think? Do we waste any space when you are dealing with your very small files? What's the minimum allocation? From user point of view, a byte, minimum allocation. But from the OS level point of view, based on this picture, what's the minimum allocation for your file? Minimum allocation. 96 is if you use all 12 block numbers. You don't need to use all 12 block numbers, right? So the minimum allocation will be 8 kilobytes. So even if you have one character data, just one byte, how much you will get allocated? 8 kilobytes. You cannot share a data block between multiple files, see? That is for this configuration. If you bigger the drive, bigger the drive it is, the data block will be bigger and bigger. Okay? Why is that? Let's go to this. So now we can talk about small versus large data blocks. Why would you go for really small data blocks? Why would you go for large data blocks? So just now we said 8 kilobytes is the minimum we allocate. Let's say you're creating a lot of small files. Chances are we write a lot of small files, right? Small programs. 1,000 bytes, 2,000 bytes, pretty small, right? That means there's a lot of internal fragmentation. It's called internal fragmentation, right? Internally, you're allocating 8 kilobytes, and there's so much is wasted. So you may think, we don't want that much wastage. Why don't we just reduce to maybe 4 kilobytes to reduce the wastage? Do you see any problems with that? Instead of 8 kilobytes, 4 kilobytes? Yes?
It means that larger files take a little bit more because we'll need more pointers.
Remember the 12 pointers? Now you have just, you have hit the direct pointer, the allocation to instead of 96 kilobytes, you have brought it down to 48 kilobytes. See? So then what will happen if you go over? Now a lot more files will go beyond 48 kilobytes. Then they, for them, you will need this. That's a memory wastage right there. See? So if you have too many data blocks, you have more overhead to manage the data blocks. See? So what you have seen is that small file systems, they have kind of a little bit smaller data blocks, but as the file system or disk drive becomes bigger and bigger, they tend to use reasonably bigger ones. Okay, there's no perfect way to do it. So that ensures that you don't have too many data blocks, and also you don't waste too much in the index blocks either. Okay, the index block also has wastage, right? If you allocate index blocks for a file, that's not storing any data. See, the real data is only here, 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 and in the end, right? That's what the real data is. Everything else is wastage. So you want to avoid all these ones, and also you want to avoid internal fragmentation. There's no one perfect way. So you have to kind of lower the block size, you waste more space here. Larger the data block size, and you waste a lot more in internal fragmentation. So that's both sides are bad. Both extremes are bad. You agree? Both extremes are bad? For data block size of 1 kilobyte, maybe? If you do 1 kilobyte, 100 KB, it requires 100 block pointers. Lot of managing the data blocks, see? On the other hand, let's say 100 KB block size. Lot of internal fragmentation, right? You're wasting lot of space internally. So both seem to be bad, right? And also, when you do reduce the block size, that has an implication on maximum possible file size. Probably we don't care about it many times because it tends to be very huge anyway. So that's not a major concern. I would say the first two are major concerns. So the directory, that's how the directory looks. Directory is nothing but a special file. We don't create, the system manages, right? You create a directory, but the managing itself, you create a file in the directory and all that. So intern system manages that file. So this is that file contents. And sometimes I have seen, I managed to kind of even look at the directory. Let's see. There you go. So somehow it manages to show here. No. OD dot maybe. No. Okay, it doesn't allow me. So sometimes it allows you to kind of directly do the binary read on the file. Let's see whether you can do sometime. So dot, every directory, this is the file, the dump of a directory. Dot means current directory. Dot indicates current directory. Dot dot indicates parent directory. This is for navigation. Okay. Then it has all the list of file names and the inode numbers. That's what each directory has. Directory does not have anything else. Okay. So anything else you display, it comes from the inode, individual inode. So that's why when you do ls, it just lists the stuff. See, ls lists only the file names. When you do ls minus a, it lists the dot files, so hidden files. So-called hidden files also are listed. I had to kind of come around this thing, black and white. Why is this thing it's showing like this? What is this? No. Okay, I'll look into that later. See, dot and dot dot. Okay. Now let's see. Ls minus id dot. Ls minus, parent is 2. Inode number is pretty small, right? So what is my parent? the parent directory is this, see? Let me explain this again. What is the inode number of dot dot parent directory? It says 2. So that's another way to confirm would be, do that. Give the parent directory itself. See? It matches with my parent directory inode number. Okay? That's basically, you know, current directory it kind of manages. So when you do cd dot dot, see, now you are in parent. To provide that connection, you have this dot dot entry automatically created. Okay? You don't create this. Every directory automatically has those. Okay? I don't know if Windows has that. Probably has, just hidden. You don't see it, probably. Okay? So then each file name and there's the inode number. Any question about this? Hopefully things will become clear as we use it more and more. Okay, that's a good place to stop. I think you guys are tired. See you in the next class.